and welcome to On the Record, where we go behind the headlines for hard-hitting analysis with the experts. Today on the show, retail reckoning. It is a $12 billion sector of Australia's economy, but have those ruling the roost been asleep at the wheel, existing on high margins and low volumes, a recipe essentially for inefficiency and one indeed that's ripe for revolution, arguably, care of competition landing on our shores sometime soon, if not indeed imminently. The Americans, the Swedes, the Japanese already scouring sites down under to mission creep in on the incumbents, and now the Spaniards no less. Just this week, with Zara, the Spanish fashion Goliath, hitting our shores, their company opening its debut store in Sydney. The move rattling, of course, local labels like Portman, Sports Girl and Q. They're already battling weak market conditions that indeed saw Colorado go under just weeks ago. Now, needless to say, it's time for domestic fashion retailers to put on their game face if they are to compete against Zara's on-trend, cut-price clothing range.
International fashion powerhouse Zara opened its first Australian store in Sydney this week, sparking a shopping frenzy usually reserved for Boxing Day sales. The move to our shores has left some analysts scratching their heads, given the fact that many of our local standalone brands are already struggling under tough trading conditions. But it seems flailing consumer sentiment isn't getting in the way of Zara's campaign for world domination. It already has plans for more stores in Australia.
We always are very cautious. We always want to do it on a store-by-store basis. We first need, as I say, we need to hear and to learn from the customers. So this is, we are going to open the first store in Sydney. We are going to open the second store in Melbourne. And after that, as many stores as the customers want.
Zara has built its global empire on the promise of turning runway fashion into off the rack with the click of its fingers. And with warehouses across Europe, clothing that appears on the catwalks of Paris can be in stores within just weeks. But it begs the question, if Zara isn't manufacturing in Australia, will we become the dumping ground for X stock?
We have yes, make sure that it's not going to happen. We have created a specific designing team to do the staff for the right season, for the proper season. So they are working, as you can see, all in this whole environment. They are aiming the specific fabrics for the specific season that is Australia living at that specific moment.
And given the clothes aren't being made here, will shoppers have to pay extra to cover shipping costs despite the strong Aussie dollar? Zara says the answer to that is a resounding no, and that it has the know-how to keep prices competitive.
What we always aim is to be competitive and to be affordable. So this is our aim in all the markets, and we have the know-how. We have the best suppliers in terms of logistics, and we have the best agreements in that sense. So of course this is something that works in this direction, but it's something that we are always aiming in all the markets, so we know how to do it.
One thing is for sure, judging by the crowds of hungry shoppers at Zara's launch, if local retailers aren't gearing up for a fight, they should be. Donna Sawyer, On the Record.
Now, to debate that and plenty more besides, in not just the bricks and mortar space for retail here, but the online medium as well. Steve Kulmar is from the consultants Retail Oasis, in black there, and Sean Hickman from myclotheshorse.com. And we're going to be also joined shortly from Melbourne as well by one key analyst at the market research company Ibis World. Ed Butler is joining the debate very shortly. But gentlemen, warm welcome to you first off. We can start with you. And perhaps, you know, Stephen, if I just get a snap view on that story that went out, you might well summarize it as, are we likely to become the wheelie bin of the world when it comes to fashion?
There is absolutely no doubt that will not be the case.
Why so?
We're dealing with an organization, Zara, which has incredible integrity in its offering. The support it has engendered from consumer over the last 20 odd years is all about the delivery of high level fashion on a constant basis. So they are not going to treat Australia or indeed South Africa or any other market in the Southern Hemisphere any differently to the way in which they are going to operate in their core or home markets.
What do you mean by integrity in its offerings? Well, because they're producing a lot of stuff out of China. A lot of people say there's not much integrity in sweatshop labour.
Well, I don't want to argue about the point of sweatshop labour.
Is that because it can't be defended?
Well, I don't think it can be defended, no. but that was really not the point that I was making. Okay. The point that I was making was the integrity of their overarching offer. Their overarching offer is about supplying constant fashion into their stores. You know, and what they're saying to us and what they've said in the rest of the world is that every 2 weeks we will deliver new stories into store. Not every 2 months, but every 2 weeks.
Because you're saying that as if it's a game-changing moment, but in fairness, that has been de rigueur in Europe, has it not?
It's not de rigueur here.
So what sort of wake-up call there for Steve Pittman, not just for bricks and mortar, but for online, which arguably is holding itself up there as being the latest sort of craze, as it were, to seize the imagination of consumers, but that's a big catch-up task. 2 weeks, big quick turnaround.
I don't think it's going to make an enormous difference in the space we're in. We sell the top Australian designers, Colette Dinigan, Zimmerman, Wayne Cooper, Fleur Wood. I don't think Zara are going to come into their demographic space. I'm more excited by the fact that the top Australian designers are now trying to push out into America, into China. Our website's already translated into Chinese. When fewer of the Australian designers get big overseas, I think the online business actually will spread out quite well. I wouldn't want to be competing, I won't say that lower end space, but I wouldn't want to be competing with Zara, otherwise I would feel financially in trouble.
Well, that was indeed the call made by Paul Zara, from no relation of course, but of course now at the helm of David Jones this week, only saying, look, their point of difference and kind of chiming what you were just saying there was that they, Zara, are trend followers rather than trendsetters. Is that a fair comment?
I think it's a fair comment, but you know, they've redefined what constitutes following pace. When we talk about trend followers, our assumptions are that it could take months from the time I see it on the catwalk or the time I see it in a leading magazine or publication online or whatever to when I see it in the store. We're talking 2 weeks.
They've also got some good branding around that. Trend followers often haven't got branding, they're just described as a price. These aren't a price point, they're good branding.
And in a lot of cases, trend followers, you could be waiting, as I said, months before you see the thing you saw in a catwalk effectively being interpreted by a designer.
Just clarify, for the ignoramuses like myself, when you say good branding, you're not meaning the swoosh that we associate with that terminology on the back of a pair of Nikes. What do you mean by good branding when referring to Zara?
I think it's very easy. Think about the last, when the Apple shop opened, the excitement and buzz we had from that. We had the same thing when Zara opened their shop. That's branding. That's excitement by the population.
Exactly. The power of the brand.
It costs an enormous amount of money to get that.
You both jet set the globe like the best of them. You'd know that vigour, that hoi polloi enthusiasm has faded in Europe for the product. I was only there just end of last year. People warily walking past that store. There's no kind of, you know, groupie goings on at the front door to herald a new range.
I don't know what part of Europe you're in.
I was in London.
I was in Barcelona in October.
The city shut over the long weekend.
I was walking their stores, and I can assure you that, and I've been walking Zara stores in America, in Europe, in Asia, for a number of years now, saying to myself, well, when are they going to make it here? Because, you know, it's an exciting, involving and engaging experience. And I think when you think about it, Carson, what they're talking about in redefining the model and redefining fashion, fast fashion, they will create such market excitement, as exampled by yesterday's peoples and crowds. They're going to kind of force Australian retailers to look at themselves and look at the way they do things. This is a really important tipping point in Australian apparel retail.
Let's bring in Ed Butler on that very point from Ibis World, joining us from Melbourne. Ed, warm welcome gladly into the show. Now, hearing those comments, as I trust you just did, when it comes to the wake-up call, when it comes to not just Zara this week, but we're already hearing scouting around the traps, the likes of Banana Republic out of the United States, the Swedes, the Japanese, firmly set on coming here sometime soon. What has to change? What hasn't been changing fast enough?
Well, basically, Australian retail, the retail space in Australia hasn't been threatened by foreigners because it's been such a small market for so long. In the wake of the GFC, suddenly we're the lone wolf at the front of the global developed pack, where we're still spending reasonably well by contrast to the likes of America and Western Europe. Mm. So suddenly we're a very appealing place to go for places like H&M and Banana Republic and yes, Zara. In order of what has to change for local producers, they have to get quicker, and they're under real threat. I mean, we've been seeing a sort of a deflationary spike cycle in the retail space for some time, and particularly in clothing, and Zara have the capacity to come in and still underprice their competition. That's tended to be their strategy in other countries so far. The thing is, though, that like what Zara have that is really new to the Australian retail space is European cachet. That's something very new, because there hasn't really been an international retail of any note in Australia, like on a wide range. They're going to come into Australia with an incredible... That's the branding that I see when I see Zara. It's that people see Europe, and they associate Europe automatically with quality. They associate it with prestige. And that's something that the likes of Witchery and Q and those direct competitors to Zara are really going to struggle against. And it's hard to tell exactly what they can do, because it's going to be difficult for those established Australian brands to rebrand themselves into sort of a prestige space without pricing themselves up.
Well, then
and it also creates...
Go on.
Well, sorry, it also creates an opportunity for Zara. I mean, it would be against their international pricing policy, but they could almost come in and actually price themselves above the likes of Q and Witchery and establish themselves as a premium provider and with a longer-term goal of lowering their prices to match the likes of Witchery and Q.
I want to get a view, because, Stephen, you're shaking your head on that one.
Well, look, I agree with everything that Ed said, with the exception of the last point. I just don't believe that Zara will compromise their business model for the sake of some short-term cash in one market. I think they will absolutely leverage off their European heritage, absolutely leverage off the incredible level of euphoria and interest in the brand, maximise their operational model in this marketplace, open stores, which they've already talking about doing, but I don't believe, unlike Ed, I just don't believe that they will alter the model. They will be constant in their pricing philosophy, but that focus on their pricing philosophy, on top of all of the other things we've been discussing, is going to make this thing pretty well bulletproof.
I'm struggling to see how, in this market, when we're focusing out solely and squarely on Australia, you flag European heritage. We've heard the language of cachet thrown around like confetti already in this segment. But we're on the bridgehead into Asia. You were talking, Stephen, about Australian designers.
Sean,
you were talking there about Australian designers wanting to sort of punch above their weight. It sounds like a very confused market. Grabbing hold of European cachet, trying to get into Asia, and promoting Australian designers.
I don't think it's very fair to say punch above their weight. Colin Dillingham's been walking around down the catwalk in Paris for probably the last decade. So that's not punching above your weight. They're already there.
Well, I think it's one entity.
And very recognised and very successful. Yeah. No, I think, as I said before, I think the top 25% Australian designers, to Zara, for them, it's just excitement about more people looking at fashion.
That's exactly right. And just to say that Zara won't look at them.
Precisely. But what you won't see, I don't believe you'll see many people, maybe in the first month you might do, but I don't think in 6 months' time you'll see people that are shopping in Strand Arcade shopping in Pitt Street Mall. They'll still be shopping in Strand Arcade. They'll still be looking for those differential top-end brands. So I don't believe they're punching above their weight. What I would be concerned about, as we discussed before, is the bottom 25% price point competitive people. I won't mention names, it's pretty obvious who they would be. They will be in trouble.
Right. Are there already signs of that this week?
Of course.
Dare I say it, with some leading stores out with some fairly lackluster numbers. Gentlemen, we're going to hold it there and take a very short break. So stay with us. Stephen Kulmar from, of course, his own retail Oasis, and then indeed Sean Hickman returning as well from, the entity that is, of course, front and centre there that we're looking at today, and Ibis World from Melbourne. Stay with us. Back in a minute.